All right, folks, so welcome to the Fit File Podcast Reboot with DC Rainmaker and DesFit, where you're going to hear about anything and everything sports tech related, whether that's sports watches, smart watches, health wearables, bike computers, trainer apps, and basically anything that you can use to level up your sports game.
This is something that both Des and myself have been talking about for quite a while now. We've done various videos in the past, many videos, in fact, over the last couple of years. You've undoubtedly seen the sports watch year in review on Des's channel. And of course, you've seen us in various antics for quite a while. We decided to go ahead and take all of the chatting that we do behind the scenes and bring that a little more forward into this year, talking about what's happened in the previous week or two from a sports tech standpoint.
For this new format of the Fit File, so we're going to mix things up a little bit here. So we're definitely going to talk about more recent news that's happened within the last week or two in the sports tech world, but we also want to do interviews with different people in the sports tech realm, whether that's people that are experts on, let's say, HRV recovery, experts on, you know, sports performance. And we also want to have more candid reactions to some of the product reviews that we just did, and also talk about some of the reactions from all you all as well.
And then finally, from a general schedule standpoint, we're going to aim for about 3, maybe 4, if you're lucky, episodes per month. So essentially, if it's a quiet week, you might see us skip things, but otherwise we're going to go for about once a week, hopefully dropping on either Friday or Saturday.
And something else actually new with this new Fit File podcast format is that we're going to be also publishing this on YouTube in addition to Spotify as well as Apple. So for those of you who are on Spotify or Apple listening to this right now, go ahead and hop over to YouTube. I think it's just going to be youtube.com/thefitfile.
Yeah, just no S at the end of it, just the Fit File, one file only. Yeah, well, we'll talk about the origin of that name in another episode. Now, you may be wondering what happened to Shane Miller, GP Llama. Fear not, he is still alive and kicking, and he will probably join us on a few episodes here and there.
All right, so let's go ahead and get into our first episode of the Fit File Podcast Reboot. So in today's episode, we're pretty much going to talk about everything new that's happened so far. When this episode comes out, I think it'll be about the third week of January-ish or so. So by now, the new Garmin Connect refresh has come out. So basically, they have redesigned the homepage for their app as well as their website. Then there's also the new Garmin HRM Fit women-specific heart rate strap. Apple got banned again for their Apple Watch, and then Samsung also came out with their, or at least announced their new Samsung Ring wearable. So I guess let's go ahead and talk about the Garmin Connect refresh first.
Sure. So Garmin, you know, the Garmin Connect app is something that people have either loved or hate, probably mostly hated as the feedback that I think we get the most for a long, long time. And I think it's one of those things where I don't actually think it's love or hate. I think it's either you just don't care or you hate it. Like, I don't think there's many people that have professed love for it. I tend to fall in the, like, eh, I didn't really bother me either way camp. But the new refresh now essentially aims to make that first page, the dashboard page, a lot cleaner and a lot easier for someone that's just getting into the Garmin ecosystem to find and figure out basically the stuff that they want on their daily and as well their sport activity tracking standpoint.
Yeah, so I think the problem Garmin has, and this is a problem they sort of created themselves, I guess you could say, is that their devices collect a lot of data, and to be able to present all that data in a meaningful fashion, but also an easy to digest fashion, is really, really challenging. And that's kind of what they've kind of run into, I think, is that, you know, there's just this kind of onslaught of data that, you know, someone will look at when they first open the app. So to kind of organize all that all and make it easy for everyone to understand is really, really going to be tough. So in terms of this new refresh, so they've kind of gone away from a more vertical scrolling manner to kind of like a horizontal plus cards sort of format. And I think what's interesting about this reboot in general is that how popular the videos were that we published on these. So, but this really goes into the fact that the user experience of the app is really, really big because, you know, this, you know, Garmin obviously has hundreds and hundreds of devices out there, but everyone uses this one app. So it was astonishing to me how popular these videos were.
And definitely. I think, you know, one of the key things they're trying to do is to make it so you can define what types of information you want. Like, for example, if you're interested in training for an event or focusing on weight loss or focusing on getting more sleep, and they will bubble up the right information applicable to that particular item. Versus in the past, they just bubbled up all the data. And, you know, if someone got a Garmin watch and they didn't want it for caring about sleep tracking or, for example, weight loss, they're still getting that data on the old Garmin Connect app versus now they can see it's just their running data or just their training load data, et cetera. And the opposite is true. If they were someone that just wanted to focus on weight loss or sleep tracking, they can do that without seeing all these crazy metrics about acute load and things like that that just didn't matter. I think they're on the right overall, like, direction. I think, you know, one of the things that we both touched about on our videos is that this is just the one tab. Like, the rest of the Garmin Connect app was largely left untouched, minus a few things here and there. I don't actually think that's a bad thing. And the reason is that all that data, you know, one of the things that Garmin has going for it is they do collect tons of data, way more data than anyone else out there does. Apple is a close second, but they collect different types of data. So there's kind of like a Venn diagram and they overlap in some areas, but not in other areas. But in terms of the data collection, it's just massive. And if you're someone that wants that data, what often happens is those refreshes or UI redesigns is that you lose like the depth of that data. Most times companies come by and they're like, we're going to simplify. And they're like, I wanted that data. That's the thing I paid for. And so they haven't touched that. You just have to go find it yourself.
Yeah, no, I think you bring up a really good point about Apple right there is that, you know, they collect a lot of data as well. And Apple has done a lot of improvements with their health app over the last probably 2 years, I would say, or so to make it a lot more digestible. But gosh, you know, 3 years ago, you would go into the health app. It was just kind of just wild west of data in there. And it was there, but oh gosh, it was so hard to find a lot of that data. So Apple's definitely made improvements in that realm as well.
Yep, absolutely.
And I think one more thing with the Garmin Connect refresh too is that, you know, I think what they're doing is they're tailoring that experience as well when you go through the actual onboarding of the new homepage where they're going to ask you what your goals are. And so it's going to actually display a lot of the information based on that little survey that you first bring up. So again, it's not like this, you know, huge slew of information when you open up the app and then you kind of have to pick and choose what you want to see. You more pick and choose your goals and then the appropriate data will display to you there.
Now, the only thing I think that I've seen the most negative feedback on this entire thing is actually the ability to get into the beta. So Garmin right now is essentially doing a random access beta thing for the general population. So, you know, people that have been on Garmin's beta programs for their watches, so they enroll that and there are public beta programs, they don't like get first in line access, which to me is just like, what? Instead, it's like the interwebs gets it at a random point. And so you go on Reddit and there's some, again, use random a lot here, random person that's got access to it, but yet someone that tests every single, you know, buys all the Garmin watches and enrolls all the public beta and provides all that feedback, can't find a way to get access to it today. So hopefully they maybe rethink a little bit how they're giving access to people. And that might, you know, get the people that want to give that feedback and want to be able to suffer through the beta bugs, because there are some quirks, there's definitely some quirks there in the public beta, get them in towards the front of the line.
You know, in terms of my overall feedback to, or, you know, kind of my reaction to the app, I think I really like the new app experience for the most part. The website, on the other hand, that's really where I like that they're mirroring a lot of the same data that's being displayed on the website. Mm-hmm. However, I'm not sure if the actual UI or layout lends well to the website experience. So where, you know, it's like the card approach, I think that's good for, let's say, like an iPad or an iPhone, but for a website, well, that's kind of a completely different medium. So I think there could be some more massaging to be done on the website end of things.
I feel like the website is like the room in the mansion, the haunted house mansion, that they open the door, they look inside, and they're like, oh.
Close the door. Just close the door.
Close the door. And I get it. Like, if you understand the history behind how Garmin Connect came to be, it started off in Motion-Based, which is a third-party company in the Bay Area. They acquired them. This is like 10 or 15 years ago. They acquired them. That team then entirely quit because Garmin tried to move them from the Bay Area to Kansas, and people didn't want that at the time. And so, like, you this follow this arc, and there was a couple-year period there where there was nobody at Garmin that really understood this platform well. And that's changed, of course, over the last 5 to 7 years. But I think there's still a lot of, like, there's a lot of baggage still left there. And I think they look at that, and there's a lot of things that they open that door, and they're like, do we have to? Does anyone really use this? And I think the thing is that people do use it, right? That's part of, again, one of Garmin's challenges in being so popular with so many devices over such a long period of time is that there are people that the desktop website is all they use, right? They don't even have a smartphone, and that's their core thing. I suspect, though, that the vast majority of people in 2024 are using a smartphone as their main, if not singular, point of entry into the Garmin Connect platform.
All right, so that's the Garmin Connect refresh. So next up, we actually have another Garmin product. So this actually was announced on the same day. So this is the Garmin HRM Fit. So this is a women's specific external heart rate monitor that clips on the bottom of a sports bra. And what they did was basically take their HRM Pro Plus heart rate strap and make a women's specific version.
Yeah, it's something that's, obviously not just limited to women, but men as well generally dislike chest straps. This is across the board. But I think for women in particular, the chafing tends to be a lot worse in some cases, and the fit is a lot worse than for men. And so it's one of the things that's good to see Garmin trying to focus on this area and trying to have a solution for it. In fact, one of the things you'll notice if you look at the patents is that 5 out of the 6 people listed on the patent are women at Garmin. So that's pretty cool. In this case, we both had people that we recruited to test it. One of the things that neither of us could test this appropriately yet. I know we had tons of comments, some of them jokingly, some of them very much not, around how you and I should test this product. Just wear a sports bra and clip it on the bottom and call it done. I was talking to my wife about this last couple of weeks, and that doesn't really accomplish the correct thing. I think that's why both of us wanted to go outside to actual women that, have different chest sizes and different sports and different things like that, and see how this works in real life from someone that actually knows chest straps fairly well over long periods of times and knows the things to look for. One of the problems with either of us wearing it is that we just, in this case, aren't going to have the right kind of, we're not going to have the chest to be able to go ahead and apply the pressure onto that strap and keep things moving around or keep things stable, depending on what we're trying to test there. And so as my wife pointed out, and she was actually really angry at some of the comments, it was really funny. She was angry at the comments saying that I should just test it myself as opposed to bringing in other people. And her point was, if you and I had done that as our sole testing method, then we would have been absolutely crucified, should have been.
Fire.
Right?
Yeah.
That's where we were just, focused on getting the right group of people there to be able to test that. So what did your people think?
I guess this kind of goes into maybe who this product is designed for. So the two individuals that I had tested were smaller chested women. So they didn't necessarily, need like a really high support sports bra by any means. So it's going to be more on the low to medium end of things. So, from their end of things, they didn't necessarily see a huge advantage to it over a traditional chest strap. So I think this is the same feedback that your wife gave, was that, the strap that's already on the bottom of a sports bra, well, that creates compression already. So in terms of reducing that additional compression, I guess that's there. But from their end of things, they're like, well, I already have that strap there. So that didn't really solve a problem for them there. But other than that, from the two people I had tested, I mean, they said it was like fine, but it wasn't something that they're going to go spend the extra, I think, $15, at least at the regular price, right?
Yeah.
I think it's like an extra $15. So on that particular strap, considering that there probably are some disadvantages to it too, like the fact that you have to kind of clip it on, it's a little bit heavier. You have to make sure those clasps are in place and stuff like that. So yeah, I guess, but in terms of the feedback that your wife gave,
very similar to my wife, as well as the secondary tester I had. Both, smaller chested, definitely very, very athletic for both of them. And so I think this is something that may appeal more to larger chested women that, have more problems with movement. That said, my wife, traditionally has had lots of problems with chafing on chest straps. And it's the core reason why she doesn't typically wear them, is just because they frustrate her so much. One of the things as well, I think that, if we look at both of our testers, that we gave them sort of like, not realizing we both did this, polar verity senses, and polar OH1, basically optical bands that go around, sort of like the whip band right here, very similar concept, just around there, and it measures optical heart rate. And for both my people, they were like, yeah, I just would have worn that instead. That just seemed like a way better solution than the chest strap. Said, it's hard for, I think, both of us to be able to like get a larger test group before something's announced. It's kind of like hard to put on Instagram. Do you have a large chest size and want to be photographed in a sports bra for review purposes. And also you need to be athletic and roughly know what you're doing with chest straps in general, right? Like that's a tough, tall order to put out there before the product is released because it's something that just attracts too much attention. But I have had people come up since then that are in the Amsterdam area that are interested in maybe giving a whirl. And so I'm going to try to connect with some of those folks and add their input into the written review at least.
Yeah, I mean, you told me to put that on my Tinder profile, and I mean, while it could have worked, I'm not really sure. But no, very much the same thing that I'm looking for actually a lot more people to get a little bit more feedback on that because I think more the better. So yeah, I think it's an interesting concept. I think it can solve a problem for people who do have particular issues who that already wear a chest heart rate strap. So
yeah, it'll be interesting. I think especially on the chafing side. To see if that solves it for larger chested women where the chafing was a problem having the actual strap underneath the sports bra itself. So I know I saw some comments just today where people have picked it up, people that have noted in the comment section of my review that they had larger chest size and started to use it. So I suspect it's only a few days until we see some of that real world feedback.
Sure. Yep. Sounds good. All right. So next up, let's talk about the Apple Watch getting banned again. And so I'll go ahead and put it up on the screen right now. I'm not sure if you saw it this morning on Twitter. So The Verge, they replied back to their own, I think, post about the Apple Watch series being banned, basically this little meme about Groundhog Day that it happened again. So in terms of... So basically, just to kind of give you a timeline, I actually wrote this all down just because the timeline's kind of crazy on this. So first of all, Apple and this company Masimo have been kind of in some legal disputes for quite some time over blood oxygen saturation patents. So, but this finally came to a head around December 21st, where they basically said that the Apple Watch Series 9 and the Ultra 2 were going to be banned from being sold in Apple retail stores, but you could still buy them from like Best Buy, Amazon, stuff like that. Is that correct?
Yep. Yeah. You could still buy them from anyone that had already procured them from Apple. So the core difference there is that Apple itself, from an ITC standpoint, could not import the watch from outside the country. They could not sell the watch. And technically speaking, they could not advertise the watch either. And there's a bunch of other nuances. However, they could deal with service and repairs of the watch. So they could still sort that out for a time period. But this did not apply to any other entities. So if Best Buy, Walmart, et cetera, had stocked up an extra million Apple Watches before this happened, which likely is what they did, as long as that transaction was completed financially before that cutoff point, then they could sell them as I saw fit.
Totally. So, and actually, let me rephrase myself. So December 21st at 3 p.m. was the last time they were going to be available in Apple retail stores. But the actual ban went into effect December 26th or something
Correct.
Like that.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Apple, of course, filed an appeal. And there was, right around Christmas time, there was also a deadline for a presidential veto. And the White House decided not to do that. However, then on December 27th, they resumed sales again because I guess the temporary ban was lifted. They lost the bid on January 17th to suspend sales. And then as of today, January 18th at 5 p.m. Eastern time, they will not be selling anymore, or I guess they'll be selling Series 9 and Ultra 2s without the SpO2 enabled. It's like keep on going back and forth. So like what exactly is happening right now?
So as of this moment, both the moment recording this as well as the moment you're listening to it, the Apple Watch is back on sale again. And this is all, by the way, very clear, only applicable to the United States of America. Outside of the rest of the world, it doesn't matter. Nothing's changed. You're still getting this. This is despite the ITC being the International Trade Commission, there's actually nothing international about it. It's just the U.S. Trade Commission. So there's doesn't impact anything outside of the U.S. But as of today, you can buy one of three Apple Watches. You can buy the Apple Watch SE second gen, which does not have any of this in it at all. So it was never part of this entire discussion. You can buy the Apple Watch Series 9 again with the blood oxygen app now disabled. And then you can buy the Apple Watch Ultra 2 also with the blood oxygen app disabled. Apple doesn't, at least from what we can tell, still sell the Series 8 or the Apple Watch Ultra 1 effectively. So this is really only concerning the Series 9 and the Ultra 2. But the way it works that now, if you were to open up those watches, the blood oxygen app is disabled and it tells you to go to your iPhone to get more information. on your iPhone in a health app. According to Apple, I haven't seen one because I'm outside the US of A. But according to Apple, you should then see on the Apple Health app a message telling you that it's been disabled and a link off to Apple support article, which in turn tells you something. I haven't seen that support article yet because, again, it hasn't technically like lit up for me. So you buy an Apple Watch, you just don't get those features.
Now, the biggest question I think that, and I've seen this all across the internet, is what is happening to people who have purchased a Series 9 or Ultra 2 that already have SpO2?
Absolutely nothing. So as long as you pre-purchased before this time, point in time, you are good to go. You're not going to get disabled. There's no interest from Massimo in doing that, or the court or CBP, or, and there's a lot of entities involved in here. So like the way this works, there was various courts and those courts worked their way through, and there's a federal appeals court, but ultimately the enforcing party here is actually Customs and Border Patrol, the same entity that talks to you when you get off your plane from Europe or Mexico or wherever it is. That same group is also handling the actual import ban, because they deal with the importation and products into the United States in terms of validating if they're banned product or not. So in this particular case, they're the ones that approved Apple's workaround. And so Apple basically, the presumption here is that they've just disabled it in software. They're very skittish on saying whether or not it was a software disablement. I asked repeatedly for official comment on this, and no, they will not comment to anyone on whether or not it's software. Of course it's software. Like, we all know it's software, but I don't know why they're being skittish on this. The Verge tried as well to get this out of them, and they're just not, they're not saying. I tried like four different ways of asking this question. And like
with
I asked,
you know,
well, I asked like, okay, so if Apple were to win their appeal, so one of the things Apple talks about a lot in their official press statement, as well as all their like press materials they're sending to media outlets, is that they still have yet another ongoing appeal that they hope to win. And they have strong reason to believe they can win. To be clear, this isn't like a straightforward patent dispute per se. There is a lot of different patent that are being discussed here and patent components. And so when you look at a patent dispute, it's not like just yay or nay for one thing. In this case, this particular case has 105 different subcomponents in it. And of those 103 subcomponents in it, and of those 103, Massimo had 97 of their like things they wanted Apple to be in trouble for, thrown out. The court decided that those were actually invalid, not from a patent standpoint, but in terms of Apple did not violate their patents for 93 of those particular, or 97 of those particular components, leaving five left over. So it's actually five little things that we're talking about here. And so it's those five remaining things that Apple has their appeal on, and they hope that when they prevail. So the point of that whole tangent was, when we get back to my question to Apple, I said, if you were to prevail on that appeal and win, that would put you back into a couple months ago of, you know, essentially having the blood oxygen app again. Do those people get that blood oxygen app enabled? Because, you know, effectively, otherwise you're buying an Apple Watch that's like this weird lesser Apple Watch right now compared to what you would have bought a few weeks ago. And the answer back there was Apple could not comment on future legal matters. And it was like, well, I get that, but I'm asking, like, from a technology standpoint, what happens to those things, right? And so I with the assumption it's just software disablement, that's the rumor behind the scenes as well. So we're just going to assume it is.
Actually, I kind of thought about this whole thing. Was like, it's very impressive that they have been able to change even the software around in terms of getting it shipped so quickly, quite frankly, to get those disabled. Because, you know, a lot of times with manufacturing, like, you know, sometimes something can sit on the box or sit on the shelf for quite like a few months before it actually gets shipped to a customer. So I think it's very impressive from the logistics standpoint that they have been able to update these watches so quickly. So from a hardware standpoint, I would say that's nearly impossible. You know,
yeah,
so,
there was rumors Mark Gurman from Bloomberg had, you know, discussed right around the Christmas timeframe how they were actually pulling watches back from Apple stores back to Apple itself. Because again, this only impacts things that Apple as a corporate entity sold, things at Best Buy didn't matter. So they can control a lot of that stuff, and only in the US fairly well. And so I think they knew this was coming, right? They've been planning. Once they lost that initial decision, they lost an initial decision a year ago, last January, and then it's been in various appeals, and then they like really lost in September, and then they like hard lost on October 25th when it came down to the 60-day timer for the presidential appeal, getting us to December 26th. So they've had a long time to have plan A, B, C, D, E, and so on down the list.
So in all your readings and everything like that, Massimo is not necessarily looking for compensation on the existing Apple Watch Series 9s and Ultra 2s that are already on the marketplace, because from a consumer rights standpoint, I think it would be extremely challenging for Apple to be able to remove a feature on, you know, something that was already purchased. I would say there's probably some laws in some countries that probably prevent that from even happening. So, in terms of like Massimo looking for some retribution on existing products that are already out,
I'm certain they are, but the lawsuit is kind of so far from that point, it doesn't really matter. And the thing is that when we're talking about ITC, all they really care about is the import of products into the country and the sale of those products, et cetera. So things that have already happened, it's literally like water under the bridge from their perspective. Now, that doesn't mean that Massimo can't get money from Apple from that down the road. If this eventually keeps on going, and this will take years, right? Massimo could eventually recoup costs. If they win at every stage along the way, they could recoup costs. And whether or not they will, I don't know. One of the things I've repeatedly said is I am definitely not taking sides on this either way in terms of who is right or wrong. I have dug through some of these documents, and I've been watching the documents from the last 14 to 30 days or so pretty closely from the actual courthouse documents. We're talking thousands of pages of documents in just the last 14 days. This is a case that's nearly a decade old, right? It's not, and the other problem is that most of those documents that have any technical depth or interest in them are all censored. They're all basically trade secrets, and everything's kind of wiped out of them. So there is really no one that can accurately judge who is right or wrong here, except, frankly, Apple, and to, I would actually argue, a lesser extent, Massimo, right? Because there's a difference that Massimo is accusing something, but only Apple actually knows in some cases whether or not they've actually broken what's going on, like broken the law in terms of patent law. Some of the nuance here is very, very detailed. And the reason why I say Massimo can claim it but not necessarily be right is because they could have their patents invalidated, which is what often happens in this case, is that because the patent process is so complex and so broken, and this isn't like favoriting any one company, it's just broken as a whole, as we'll talk about in the Samsung Ring thing in a second. There's cases that we saw also with the Wahoo and Zwift case where, you know, Wahoo pushed on that case with Zwift up until the point where the judge basically was like, we're probably going to invalidate some of your patents here. In which case it was like, oh, let's get a settlement. Because if you have your patents invalidated, then it's like open season from a hunting standpoint, versus it's much better when you get really close to that happening to settle. That way the patent still stands, it's still there, because the company that was going to aim to get invalidated just says, yeah, never mind, and just walks away. And so there's no way anyone outside of that courtroom can really know what's right or wrong. It's just a case of who honestly has the best lawyers, and then who has the most money to get to the end of this case. And Massimo is not a small company. I think people might think that. They are a giant medical behemoth with a lot of money and a lot of reasons financially and patent-wise to keep pushing on this.
Yeah, gosh. I mean, and can you, all I'll comment on is the lawyer's fees. Wow. Like,
it's a lot. It'll be interesting. I think what's actually honestly more interesting is see what's going to happen next September, right? For the Apple Watch. X10, whatever the heck they call it, and the Ultra 3, mm-hmm. or whatever it's going to be called if they have a new one then. And probably also an SE3. That would be about the time frame we'd expect on a two-ish year cycle or so. Will they go to something entirely differently? Certainly, there's tons of other companies that have blood oxygen sensors in their watches that Massimo has not sued, or at least we haven't heard from, right? I mean, that can be Fitbit and Google and Coros and Polar and Garmin and virtually Samsung. I mean, literally every other company has this in it. So
cool. All right. Yeah. So speaking of patents and some interesting things surrounding that, so let's go ahead and move on to the announcement that, let's see, I think it either happened yesterday or today, the Samsung Ring that Samsung announced. So this was one of the shortest announcements I think I've ever seen. It was a, I think you put it in your video. It's like, it's a one more thing, but it was like a, here's one more thing. I mean, literally, I'm going to say one word, ring. Yeah. That's about it.
So basically, the Samsung Galaxy Ring. End words. pretty swirling ring into the galaxy and just disappears into the stars, right? And that was it.
You know, after the end of this very long Samsung keynote, their Unpacked event or something, whatever they call it, after I think some of their health announcements, which I do think relate to the ring for sure.
Yeah, definitely.
They basically showed, these pretty pictures and illustrations of this new health wearable. It's basically going to be a health ring, very much like an Aura ring right here. Yeah. So it's kind of interesting. So they, at CES about a week or two ago, Amazfit also announced a new health wearable ring, but Samsung went ahead and just kind of plopped this announcement at the end. I think it creates a lot of excitement, but them not saying anything says a lot, is what how I'd put it.
Yeah, I. it's funny. Like, they show the picture of the ring, and I mean, there's a couple obvious things. You can see the infrared sensor bumps, just like the Aura ring. Those are the three little bumps on the inside of the ring. That's what Aura uses for infrared, primarily for, ironically enough, blood oxygenation level tracking at night. And then beyond that, you can't really see much. You see four little contact pads. That's not likely for charging for consumers. It's likely for manufacturer download of firmware onto the device at high speed and stuff like that. And Aura has the same thing. It's got eight little contact pads. Otherwise, it looks essentially like an Aura ring. There's some differences in the infrared sensor bumps being elongated on Samsung's versus round on Aura's. But we have no information on pricing or availability or things like that. But I think, you know, as I said in my video, Samsung is nothing if not incredibly predictable. And like, if we look at pricing and we look at availability, these things shouldn't be too hard to figure out. And for example, on the pricing side, Samsung has always leveraged their wearables as a carrot to buy their phones and other devices. They've never had a strong interest in making pure profit on their watches. It's always been, you know, even the days before announcement, here's a trade-in offer to get the newest watch for free or for $50 or whatever the case is, and something that you would never see an Apple or a Garmin or really any other watch company do. And so I would expect the same thing is going to apply here, where they're going to leverage the ring as a package bundle when you buy a new phone and get something there. And the ring, I suspect, will be priced between $199 to $249, maybe $299, the same price as the Aura ring, but I think that's dangerous territory there. I would not expect a subscription service, though, which is what Aura has, $6 a month. I don't see Samsung getting into that. It's very difficult to do on a global scale, and Samsung likes to be able to have their products in the global market, even arguably more so than Apple does, especially if you look at Africa and other areas. And so that's really hard to do, that subscription service globally, compared to doing it in just a few countries.
Now, I agree with you that I doubt we'll see a subscription model with this new Samsung Galaxy Ring. However, based on their Galaxy watches that have features that are dependent on you having a Galaxy phone,
yep,
I would anticipate that there's going to be some features that are going to be probably linked to having a Samsung Galaxy phone. So,
yeah,
you know, kind of writing's on the wall based on what they've done before in the past there. What's interesting about this whole announcement, you know, you were talking about pricing and availability and all that kind of stuff. There were no mentions about features. And I think that kind of goes back to the, you know, maybe the patent argument right there. So, you know, yes, you can see the heart rate sensor bumps. You can see, you know, the metal contact points. But did they explicitly say it's going to measure heart rate? It's going to measure SpO2? Is it going to measure temperature? Is it going to have an accelerometer? Is it going to have gyroscopes inside? Probably. But in terms of defining those features, that was what was most interesting for me about the announcement, that they didn't define any of those features.
Well, there's a lot of really interesting legal reasons for that. And for that, before we get into the reasons why, it's probably entertaining to note that about a half an hour after I posted my written post on the Samsung Galaxy Ring, I got an unsolicited email from Aura with a statement, an unsolicited email with an unsolicited statement. And I know they're PR people, so it's not like it's like the first time I've heard of them before or from them before. But it was funny. It was a two-paragraph statement distributed to their CEO. And the first paragraph is basically Aura talking about how awesome they are. And then the second paragraph is Aura talking about how many lawyers they have. And, you know, it's hilarious. Like, it's one of those things where they're like, you know, they end on the whole thing of new players entering this space is validation for the category and drives us to aim higher to serve our members and community. But the preceding three lines are them saying, with new features released regularly, Aura has the strongest IP portfolio, so intellectual property portfolio, in both hardware and software for the smart ring form factor, with 100 granted patents, 270 pending patent applications, and 130 plus registered trademarks, right? They walked into the party being like, congrats, Samsung. We're here to F you up, right? Like, and Aura, like, I'm not dissing Aura's product. I'm wearing it. And, you know, it's a very strong, well-executed product. But Aura generally tends to resolve its disputes legally. And we've seen this repeatedly over the last number of years that when a new player enters the market, generally speaking, Aura will sue that new player. And, you know, in some cases, there's good reason for that. Ultrahuman was a company that entered the market this past wherever, and they have a new app design out as well. And that app design is 100% a complete and total ripoff of the Aura app design. Like, the screens are identical. Like, you couldn't, I wouldn't even say it's hard to be that identical across the board. like, it's legitimately took some effort. So, like, and again, that's getting into the nuances of patent applications and copying, all that kind of stuff. That's a whole different ballgame that'll be, you know, dealt with in courts over the course of a number of years. But I think one of the things that Samsung's done by not announcing pricing, by not announcing product, by not announcing features, is they've pushed that legal battle to a different day, because Aura can't sue them for something that hasn't actually been put for sale. And that's an important distinction, that you have to have something for sale in order to be sued for it. The mere act of talking about it does not count. We saw that with the Zwift hub in Wahoo, that Wahoo sued them the day it went for sale, not when it was first announced 30 plus days earlier. And so this is the case where I wonder behind the scenes if now Samsung is going to go back to Aura and be like, okay, what do we need to do to get some of these patent disputes solved? And it's funny because I responded back to this unsolicited email from Aura. I said, okay, cool. Thanks for this note. Just a quick clarification. Have you guys been working with Samsung at all from a licensing standpoint or any technology collaboration standpoint? And they came back like within minutes and said, hey, we'll get the answer for you. Just hang on a second. And then like an hour or two went by and I'm like, knock, knock, anyone there? Like, hey, we're getting for you. Just we're almost done. We should have it for you shortly. A couple hours went by, knock, knock, knock. We're still working on it. And then here we are like now 24 hours later, and they sent another email a little bit ago saying, we haven't finalized this yet, right? And it's like, I think they're realizing that by saying something, they're getting themselves in a potential like legal pickle of they can just sort of wait now and see what happens.
Let's just talk about it, like, you know, in theory, from a technology standpoint. Let's just say Samsung came up with their, you know, their own hardware. The one thing that I think we've talked about before in the past is Samsung, they kind of like to boil the ocean. They like to come out with anything and everything. And going back to their watches, I think you hinted at this in your video, is that, you know, it's like, I don't know if they've necessarily nailed those fundamentals in their watches quite yet, and they're kind of moving to another product space at this point. So in terms of, you know, accuracy, again, we're always hopeful with every new Samsung release that it's going to be more accurate than the last, which is, I think, generally an easy task.
Very, very
task.
Low bar, right? There's the floor, yeah. And it's roughly just a tiny bit above the floor for the heart rate accuracy.
Sure, sure, exactly. So, you know, so that's where, you know, this is going to be a first-gen product, whether it's using other technology or not, regardless. So I think what's interesting about it is that going back to their Samsung Health updates, where they were talking about having like a readiness score type of feature, as well as having more detailed sleep tracking. So, you know, again, this is all reliant on the hardware and if it's going to be accurate. So, you know, kind of going back, they have like a body composition feature on their watch, which is in general pretty hit and miss, at least for the results that I got out of it. So, you know, I think this is expanding to a portion of the industry that I don't look to Samsung for these types of metrics, I guess you could say.
Yep. No, it's going to be interesting because I think one of the things that, you know, both you and I in our videos on the Samsung watch, we focus a lot on accuracy because it's a fitness watch. And from our perspective, we focus on the fitness aspects of it as opposed to like calling friends or doing all the general smartwatch things. And you know, so every once in a while, both you and I get comments on our Samsung Watch videos that are like, who cares about accuracy? It has all these other features that I care about instead, which is totally fine, right? Like, I don't care about most of the features, but I do care about accuracy. In the case of the Ring, though, it's a much more challenging thing for Samsung because they have to get these right. Like, this, the single purpose of this Ring is to be correct from a biometric standpoint the vast majority of the time. And when it's not, this has no purpose. Versus the watch, you can, you know, play like what matters to me sort of thing.
Yeah, in terms of the metrics, I mean, this is you know, not about wearing, this is not like about showing off your watch. I mean, not necessarily, I mean, and this can be Samsung, Garmin, Apple, whatever, you know, it's like, it's definitely not about showing off a device. You know, this is about, you know, you and your metrics. So that's really where it's going to be important. Honestly, this, the Aura Ring, it really has been my favorite from the sleep tracking standpoint because, I mean, this is the most unobtrusive device that, you know, I've ever been able to use that's been able to collect all those metrics. I mean, a watch is just on, I mean, we're used to wearing watches and big watches to sleep and stuff like that, but, you know, a ring is really by far the best thing to do. One more thing that you mentioned in your video was kind of the logistics.
You actually watched my video. Impressive.
I mean, you know, I'm sitting on the trainer. I got to do something, right?
Everything else is taken. Fine, I'll watch this.
Exactly. you know, one more thing that you brought up in your video was like sizing, because that's a huge challenge with a wearable like this. So, you know, sizing, you really do have to have the right size, not only for comfort, but also for accuracy. Now, and this is where you did not watch my Aura Ring video, but so Aura Ring actually does have actually sizing stations in Best Buy stores now. So that, I mean, honestly, it was something that I learned doing this Aura Ring video, but yeah, actually at select Best Buy locations, they actually have an Aura Ring sizing station in there. However, at the same time, Samsung is in every single Best Buy out there, you know? Yeah. And you know, we're not talking about like a small little station. We're talking about gigantic displays. They're probably one of the most prominent, you know, companies in a Best Buy. I mean, not only their TVs, phones, watches, whatever. I mean, they have so much floor space. So for them to have like a sizing station in there definitely helps them expand their reach.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think that's the big challenge that Aura has always had up until apparently this Best Buy station is, you know, getting that entire, the sales process has a lot of blockers in it for people versus the one click or just walk into a store and pick up a watch and be done with it. And I think one of the points my wife's made, she bought one a couple of years ago, when I was trying to get her opinion on some of the female health tracking stuff. And she stopped wearing it because she's like, I don't see the point since my watch already does all of this. And so I think as smartwatches become even more prolific than they already are over the last couple of years, it's just continues to eat into Aura's territory, as well as any smart ring territory. And don't get me wrong, there's some people that don't like wearing watches all the time, including to bed. So that's certainly a scenario for that. But it's just getting that market is changing, and it's tough. I think it becomes tougher for ring companies. But let me just see what Samsung does if and when they get this out. I assume if at some point, but we've had certainly products over the years that never actually make it to fruition too. So
based on like Amazfit coming out with a ring this year and Samsung, I think it's just going to be, I don't want to say the year of the ring, but it's certainly going to be another viable option for people who don't want to wear a watch or a Whoop or something else along those lines.
Yep, exactly.
Yep. All right. So last thing, let's just go ahead and talk. This was just something kind of interesting that we can just like spend a few quick minutes on. But you had a running track rabbit hole. So talk us through that little thing really fast.
I listened to the internet and that was my mistake.
Oh, man.
On like a Friday evening, I get like a YouTube notification. I don't know how YouTube decides what comments to send me notifications on, but I get notifications on lots of comments, but not all comments. But for whatever reason, this one they decided to send me a comment notification on. And it was someone saying, hey, you're the track, just so you know, that track isn't 400 meters on lane one. The one I had just done a piece on how a new track feature worked and things like that. And it's a running track that I use. It's just a few hundred meters from the DCR cave. It's amazing, beautiful track. And I use it for all of my testing, for all the track modes, for all these devices for many, many years. So someone saying to me that lane one is not 400 meters is like that's weird, but also seriously problematic for me on many different levels. So I'm like, okay, I don't think that's the case. Like, I lived here now for almost, what, 5, 6 years or something like that? And no one's ever said this in any video or post before. And they've seen this track, and tons of Amsterdam folks know this track. And no one's ever commented that it's not 400 meters on lane one, which would be pretty unusual. But it's also an unusual track because it's got four lanes as opposed to like 6 or 8 lanes, because it's designed to be a warm-up track for Olympic Stadium, which is directly next door to it. So you can get out and run Olympic Stadium, beautiful, well, as you might imply, like an Olympic-level stadium. But it's kind of hard to get in and out sometimes there, or getting in, I guess, anyways. And you get out sometimes, too, if you get in questionable ways. But point is, this track here is smaller, but not like on the loop in theory. And so I'm like, huh, I'll just go out and measure it. And that led me down this entire rabbit hole of how exactly you measure a track, because it's not quite what you think. And so, you know, you'd be like, okay, where on the lane do you that measurement come from? And so it depends on whether or not that track has a curb or no curb around the corners. And most tracks that have curbs don't have curbs on the straightaways. They just have them on the corners because people are moving crap back and forth on the straightaways and stuff. So it only matters if you have a curb. And so from that answer, it is 30 centimeters if it has a curb from the edge of the curb into the middle of the track is where you measure that lane from. So if you were to measure against that left-hand side curb, then it would actually be under 400 meters. It'd be about 397 or so odd meters. So I went out and measured all these things using a measuring wheel that I have from back in the DC days. So it's now like, I don't know, 15 years old, give or take. So it's been across like a few moves. It's had its head beat a few times, right? This is not like something that I would go out and, you know, measure the Olympic course on or something like that. I went out and did it. Also, it was hailing and snowing out at the time. So like not ideal conditions for doing this because the hail could cause some slippage on the track. But my first round, I got within a meter, give or take, of the actual, you know, 400 meters. But the challenge is that you're trying to keep this straight. Like I don't have a way to keep this straight in the hail going around this track at exactly 30 centimeters off the thing. So I measured this a few times, got within a meter each time of 400 meters being slightly under, which makes sense because as I went around the curves, I would keep gravitating towards the inside of the lane just by habit, I guess. Close enough, given the fact that this, again, this measuring wheel has been bonked upside the head many times over the last 15 years. Moves, all sorts of stuff. But it was like, still isn't good enough. So I'm going to go and find like some authority on this. And there's nothing at the track written about the track itself lane distances, because why would there be? But while I was doing this whole loop-de-loop thing, this like 80-year-old guy came up to me and he's like, why are you measuring the track? I'm like, well, a friend said it's not, you know, 400 meters. And he looked at me like, your friend's an effing idiot. He's like, of course it's 400 meters. And I did it like 2 or 3 times. And there's like the second time he comes around, he stops at the line that I had was about to come up to and stop and measure it. And he just stops there and like looks and he's like, 400 meters, right? And I'm like, yep, but it's in feet because it's an American one. So I had to convert it first real quick. But he's like, I told you. I'm like, I know it's 400 meters, but I got to prove this out. But I guess step one, never disbelieve the old man at the track, right? This guy's out there just he was doing
he's
like
wise.
These repeats, 80 years old in the hail and the rain or the hail and the snow, right? So I see these signs and it has an email address for the city. This is a city run track. I'm like, okay, I'll just email them and see if they have more information. But while I'm doing this, about to email them, I'm like, oh, I have a website. And when I have the website, I find like the more official name of the track in Dutch, as opposed to what it's kind of more commonly known as. So I'm like, huh, we just copy and paste that into the Googles and see what Google comes back with and put the word 400 meter after it. And surprisingly, it comes back with this Dutch track certifying authority that their responsibility in life is to certify all of the tracks in Netherlands. And they have to do this every 3 years. So they certify every track every 3 years and produce a report, a PDF report about that certification of each track. And lo and behold, my track was on there and there's a PDF report on it. And the PDF report lists the compliance for all these different things. And because this is only a 4-lane track and not an 8-lane track, it's not compliant for like normal races because you wouldn't want to book this track thinking you're going to hold a track meet on it and be like, well, yeah, half a track, folks. Like we can't put all these athletes here. But it talks about how like the hurdles area is compliant and the steeplechase area is compliant and long jump's compliant and got diagrams and charts and all this kind of stuff. And then it lists exactly the lane length and stuff like that. So at this point, I'm like, my case is solved. I've spent hours on this now for something that should not have been. But my rabbit hole was complete, and I responded back with like some of the stuff to the guy. And he's like, oh, I guess, interesting, good to know. I also went, by the way, to someone in charge of running events at Olympic Stadium, and they confirmed it was 400 meters. Like, I asked a lot of people about this and confirmed a lot of different ways, and I'm set.
And this is why you should definitely subscribe to dcrainmaker.com for interesting, useless, but extremely interesting information like this. So.
That's the problem, is that I determined not to make a video on this, because I was like, this was a rabbit hole already going downhill. I figured I was going to go out there and do one loop around this and be like, fine, done, respond back to the internet comment. I did it. It's 400 meters. Be done with it. And then I'm like, maybe I should do it twice and three times. Before I knew it, my whole day was spent on this.
You'll have to understand, though. It's like there are these subjects that come up that just basically, and Ray and I have a specific term for this that we joke each other back and forth with, but there's basically like these subjects that come up that we basically cannot let go until we are done extinguishing, going down that rabbit hole, digging down to the middle of the earth and coming back up. And this is exactly one of those.
And yeah, and it's not, in this case, it wasn't just like someone said something wrong on the internet. It was also, this is like a fundamental part of my testing and that exactly. track. And I needed to know that track was right. Even though Garmin said it's right from their track database, and Coro said it's right, and Apple said it's right, and Wahoo actually came up and measured this darn track themselves back a couple years ago when they implemented it, knowing that I would test there, they sent out a guy to like validate everything first. So like I wanted to, I knew this track was correct, but still in the back of your mind, you're like, maybe it's not, right? Maybe it's just all these big companies got it wrong and this one guy on the internet got it right. So we will talk about that term another day, because it's we have a funny term for it, and how we utilize that term is entertaining.
Yeah, exactly. All right, so that's going to wrap up the first reboot episode of the FitFile podcast. So for the next episode, we've got a lot of things to talk about. We're going to talk about winter training. We're going to talk about some updates, as well as some other things that are going to happen in the sports tech world. So I don't think I mentioned this at the beginning of the episode, but in terms of something else that's new with this new format is that the FitFile podcast was originally available on Spotify as well as Apple Podcasts. Was it available on any other platform at that time?
It's available in a bunch of places.
Okay, yeah. So
you can find it at dcrainmaker.com/podcast, by the way. The links to all those places.
Absolutely. But something new for this new format is that we're also going to be doing a video on top of this. So this is where you're going to be able to find us on YouTube as well. So we would highly encourage you to hop over to YouTube. I think it's just at the Fit File, basically youtube.com/the Fit File. And
I'd highly encourage you. We'll put it in the show notes as well, so you can just clickety-clack that too.
Yep, absolutely. So so that way you can go ahead and view this episode as well. That way, I don't know, it's like you can put this in front of you when you're on the trainer, or, you know, like watch this in the evening, something like that. And we'll try to also put some nice juicy B-roll on top of some of these clips as well, just so it makes it a little bit more entertaining than just seeing our faces.
Exactly. Perfect. Well, thanks. Hopefully everybody enjoyed it. Definitely give us our feedback via Twitter or X or whatever the heck it's called now, as well as in the YouTube comments, things that you might want or see us to cover in the future, as well as maybe ideas for people that you want us to interview too. We're certainly open to ideas, and like any new kind of, or even rebooted production, we'll probably take a few episodes to find our way and kind of get things stabilized a little bit.
Yep. All right. Yeah. Thanks very much for listening or watching, and we'll see you in the next episode.
Yep. Have a good one.